Napoleon III said to Henry Poole, I'm going to make you my royal tailor. I'm going to give you my royal warrant.
Really what you're looking at here is probably what the V&A would now probably call national historical importance.
People don't really understand what Savile Row represents. It's really something of a mystery.
If anybody who's used my scissors, I know.
It's a tough life.
I used to cut up newspapers and try to make it into garments. And it was mysterious.
Fashion was a scary, powerful force, the like of which, you know, London society had never seen.
This exploration started with a simple question. What is luxury? What is the most common view that the world has of high-end luxury? To many of us, it's a world of don't you dare ask the price, for that means that you cannot afford it, or brand names that are intimidating to even pronounce because they happen in exotic languages, rituals that are fairly exclusionary, and so on. What we really, really believe is that there's a human story that is hidden and waiting to be discovered in virtually every single question that we seek to answer. And in the case of luxury, we have always wondered, is there something to the idea of luxury that goes beyond the maybe valid and yet commonly held views? Something that each of us can deeply connect with, even if you're not from these rarefied worlds. It is the search for this that brings us to London. I'm Rajesh Sahadevan, and we are at what is arguably the mecca of luxury when it comes to bespoke tailoring. Savile Row has dressed some of the biggest legends that we have ever known. It is also home to some of the most legendary tailoring houses for men's bespoke suits.
Savile was the maiden name of Dorothy Savile, who was the wife of the Earl of Burlington. And he lived in Burlington House, which was a grand estate on the edge of London. But back in 1700, he owned all the land, which is where Savile Row is today. There were no streets there. It was just beautiful manicured gardens. But he eventually spent so much money on architecture and on great parties that he had to rent out his land and he had to create streets. So one of his first streets he named after his wife. So he called it Savile Row. In Japan, they use the word sabiro to mean suit, which is, it sounds like Savile Row. Yeah. So it's an internationally famous name, but it simply was the name of his wife. Yeah.
Obviously, just above the mirror here, we have Queen Victoria's royal warrant, and we've held a royal warrant with every successive British monarch to the current day with Her Majesty.
So how many royal warrants is it in all?
We actually hold the world record. No company before or since has held so many, which is about 40. Yes, which is quite a feat. We are fortunate. We've got the Shah of Persia, Khedive of Egypt, Tsars of Russia, Emperor of Brazil, Mexico, Emperor of Japan, Emperor Haile Selassie of Ethiopia.
Somebody from India as well.
We've had a number of Maharajas from India.
Well, because originally Savile Row was a street for wealthy residents, friends of the Earl of Burlington. You know, if you have to sell your land, you want to put your best friends on that street. And then gradually, Retired admirals and generals, top politicians moved into Savile Row. So it was still a really exclusive residential street. Okay. No hint of trade at all. Okay. And then doctors started moving in. And this is in the day when doctors were really experimenting with surgery. And they would operate on patients in their own homes, in their houses. And they wanted to be on Savile Row because they would get the wealthy patients who were willing to spend more money on this new surgery. Maybe it was a broken leg, or maybe it was something even more serious. So it was that sort of street. It was a street for politicians and doctors. And it wasn't until 1846 that Henry Poole had this idea. He was a tailor, and he had this idea, I am going to choose the best street, the most exclusive street for my tailoring house. And so he opened up on Savile Row, and it was shocking, and people didn't like it because it wasn't a street where business was supposed to happen, trade, you know, no signs, no nothing. But fortunately, one of his customers was the Emperor of France, Louis Napoleon, or Napoleon III. And Napoleon III said to Henry Poole, I'm going to make you my royal tailor. I'm going to give you my royal warrant. So Henry Poole proclaimed this with a crown and an eagle, a massive sign in the front of his tailoring house. And so the residents went from being upset that a tailor was on the street to actually rather excited about it, because, well, if you have to have a tailor, you may as well have the Emperor of France's tailor, you know. And then shortly after that, he became the tailor to the Prince of Wales. And from that moment on, other tailors wanted to come to Savile Row and feed off the importance of Henry Poole's establishment.
Really what you're looking at here is probably what the V&A would now probably call national historical importance. So we start in 1846 when Henry Poole took over up here. And we've got about 130 of these, and I think we can get up to pretty much 1950s, maybe early 60s. So it's an entry for customers. And here's a good one, I suppose, because this is Churchill's. So this is 1906, looks like January by the looks of it, I hope it is, when he was Parliamentary Undersecretary for the Colonies. And it will just simply tell you what he's got now, but it tells you what he had and then how much it cost him.
So you really are talking about the who's who, isn't it, when it comes to Savile Row? There's Winston Churchill, there's Barack Obama, Tom Cruise, David Beckham, Brian Lara, and so on. But who are these people here in Savile Row who helped dress up some of the wealthiest, the most famous, and probably the most accomplished people in the world?
I came from the foothills of the northern range of mountains in Trinidad. Trinidad and Tobago, I don't know if you know where that is, but you know, we're famous for cricket in the West Indies. My grandparents came from India. I wanted to become a tailor. And I guess that was probably because we didn't have very much coming from a very, very humble background. And the only way I can make things for myself, I used to cut up newspaper, actually. It's probably the origami of fashion or style or tailoring. I used to cut up newspapers and try to make it into garments. And it was mysterious to me. I'm growing up in the hills, there was flora, fauna, there was excitement, fruit trees, birds, you know, to Twitch's paradise. Exciting place, coconut trees. When you climb up a tall coconut tree and you sit in the branches, you can look far and wide. And you, we used to see planes flying by, but you never thought one day you'll get on a plane. My father did all sorts of jobs, all sorts of odd jobs. He was a barman, he was a gardener, he was a cleaner, he was a messenger, car park attendant. You know, he did all sorts of things to make ends meet. My father's background is mining coal, but charcoal, you know, the stuff that people use for barbecue, where they actually dig the pit. My mother, she was a homemaker, and for those who were more wealthy, she would, or lived a luxurious lifestyle, that she used to cook for them. Okay. But she used to cook for them in exchange, not for money, but for food for the children. There are five of us. So, you know, we came from very, very humble backgrounds. The person I was learning to make jackets with, he had been to London in the 60s and did a pattern cutting course, okay, and then went back to Trinidad and decided to start his own business. So he lit up my impressionable mind and exaggerated so much about Savile Row, yeah, knowing that I would never get there. Okay. But little did he know, he excited me so much, I began to have a goal. But I had a goal now with the purpose of where I wanted to be. So I learned my trade very well. And as a young 16-year-old, I had a pretty good reputation, okay, for making really nice suits. But that reputation, and I was encouraged with that reputation to go to Canada, to go to America. But it wasn't Savile Row. Having left school at a young age, we went to school just to learn the basics. I hadn't read a book. I hadn't learned geography. I didn't know where Savile Row was. Okay. So I didn't come to Europe. I didn't come to England. I came to Savile Row. Okay. And so in one of those very luxury boats, I actually bought a return ticket. And I sailed to Savile Row.
Number 3 Savile Row, right?
Yes, and it was on this roof on the 30th of January, 1969, that the Beatles gave their last live performance. And it was completely unexpected. It went on for about 45 minutes until the Metropolitan Police had to shut it down. And we know they recorded at least 5 songs, several takes of the songs. But, you know, this was their music studio. It was called Apple Music Studio. And they were, you know, heading toward the end. They knew they weren't going to be together that much longer. So they knew this was their last live performance. And it was a bit of fun, a bit of spontaneity, you know. And but what's really special in terms of Savile Row history is that both John Lennon and Paul McCartney were wearing suits made by Tommy Nutter. The connection was that Tommy Nutter's boyfriend, Peter Brown, was basically managing the Beatles in those days. Okay. You know, Brian Epstein had passed away, and Peter Brown stepped into his shoes. And fortunately, Tommy Nutter knew all these musical people, and he had their backing to open his tailoring house. Okay. So what Tommy Nutter wanted to do was bring Carnaby Street fashion and King's Road fashion, really trend-setting clothes of the 1960s and 70s, to Savile Row, to marry it with Savile Row quality. And basically, once he did, and once he had the Beatles wearing his clothes, then he was able to have celebrities like Elton John and Mick Jagger and, you know, all kinds of musicians from the Rolling Stones wearing his clothes.
I mean, it really is very special. And I think people don't really understand what Savile Row represents. It's really something of a mystery. Generally, people would annotate Savile Row with something which is very expensive, so very much beyond their means, and perhaps a little old-fashioned. In reality, it's very, very different. The books generally that are written, have been written about Savile Row, have been very factual. And therefore, they tend to be a little bit cold and remote. Richard wrote a book called Written Smooth. And that's his experience of coming, coming in from a completely different environment, coming into Savile Row and then beginning to see these beautiful, the amount of work that was going on, works of art, really. And then picking up a material that we, for a garment which would probably sell for £5,000, £10,000, £15,000. What an enormous experience. And I think that what he showed is the human side of the people who work in Savile Row. We're all very ordinary people.
Well, I came from a perfectly normal sort of middle-of-the-road family. My father actually managed a clothes shop.
Okay.
Which is... I came into this business because he told me not to. I thought, what was he trying to hide? And it becomes something that you have to love this. If you don't love it, it will drive you mad.
Yeah.
But if you like it, you can research all sorts of things like how uniformed looked 200 years ago and try and adapt some of those principles into today. And so I grew up in a semi-detached house in Slough.
Where is it?
Slough.
Slough, okay.
And moved to London for a short period of time and stayed in Victoria.
Okay.
When I got married, and then I moved to Bromley, which is in Kent.
And somewhere into the story comes the prince of the cult of Dandy.
Yes, Bill Brummel. Mm. Bill Brummel, he's the son of the secretary to the prime minister.
Okay.
So he's not a member of the aristocracy. Everyone that really mattered was a member of the aristocracy. You have to say that at first. Bill Brummel wasn't.
And then, so Bill Brummel grows up with enough money to go to the best schools, to go to Eton, and he's very attractive young man. And he loves wearing military uniforms. And he eventually gets himself a position in the Prince's 10th Light Dragoons. So eventually, Bill Brummel got out of the 10th Light Dragoons, largely because they were moving to Manchester, and he couldn't leave Manchester. He had to stay in London. And that was when he became a civilian, and this is mid-1790s, and he starts developing the suit. You know, I mean, from the beginning, the Prince of Wales was admiring Brummel because, of course, Brummel was in his regiment and they became close friends. So the Prince kept trying to look as good as Brummel could look. Well, Brummel, he would spend 5 hours a day on his dress, on his toilet, which meant, you know, the bathing process. He bathed twice. And anyway, he did all of this on the first floor of his apartment in Mayfair. Downstairs, young men would congregate, crowd in there, hoping that they'd get invited upstairs. Bathed in warm milk, and then exfoliated vigorously with a brush, and then bathed again in hot water. And, you know, he shaved himself. He's always clean shaven. He didn't wear wigs. This was important. He cut his hair short. It's supposed to be like the Romans, a Titan haircut. And he would just focus on everything being as perfect as possible. The real art of the most complicated thing in the procedure was putting on his tie, his neck tie, you know, which was this long piece of material, about 5 feet long, that he would wrap around and have to have it evenly spaced, and that, you know, and it had to be fresh linen.
And it's also true that the Prince of Wales used to go to Brummel's house to watch the show.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes. So court was transferred from the real palace to that apartment in Mayfair. It's an astonishing thing. Yeah, a real topsy-turviness. And you know, you can say that dress was doing that. The interest in fashion made it possible for upstarts to suddenly find themselves invited in, you know, grand, beautiful rooms, places where they didn't belong. Fashion was a scary, powerful force, the like of which, you know, London society had never seen.
Family were dock workers, so from Essex, Tilbury, to very much a dock town. I say very working class, ordinary sort of people. With good upbringing, taught right and wrongs and work hard. You get nothing for nothing. Strangely, actually, a lot of what I do now are words that have things that come into my life from my father, you know. Like working hard, you know, being nice to people. Just sort of simple, basic, life experiences where you're just being, you know, true to yourself, nice. Suddenly you look back and you think, that was true, you know.
It's important,
yeah, you know. As I say, I'm a pretty ordinary guy.
But what is remarkable is that this mecca of luxury has virtually been created by people who came from fairly humble backgrounds, be it Andrew Ramroop, Richard Anderson, Ray Stowers, or even Tommy Nutter, whose father, it is said, ran a cafe that catered to working class customers. It is also equally remarkable that the design of the bespoke suit finds its origins in professions that had fairly utilitarian demands, be it the doctors, the military, the world of horse riding, and even rowing.
The first one to mention is the suit of armor, going back to the days of Henry VIII. And you know, the suit of armor is this, this firm plate of steel, a metal that is protecting the breast and makes the wearer look stronger and bigger than he actually is. And so we still say that the suit, makes the chest look stronger and make the depth of the chest be deeper. So that's the first thing. But you know, with the epaulettes that soldiers would wear, of course, they would make you look, as you're going into battle, extremely fierce and mighty. Well, the suit, the structure of the British suit still has that aspect to it of building up the shoulders. You can really build them up with a rope shoulder, or you can have the soft shoulder. And they can do a very soft look. They can do an unlined suit. There's nothing they can't do. But often when we think of, traditional British style, we think of something a bit more structured. But there's lots of little details. The buttons on the suit, they are connected back to the days of the doctors. So when the tailors came in, they put buttons there so the doctors could unbutton them, roll up their sleeves, and work on their patients, and keep their coat on. So there's that. Then you have things like the flaps in the back, and those were put there so that you could ride horses and you could put your coat out. So with rowing, you needed an action shoulder, which is an extra bit of material which allows, your arm comfortably to move. Always with the suit, the idea is that the arm can move for a steering wheel or to ride or whatever, and yet the collar is supposed to stay firmly down, the lapel is supposed to stay connected. So it's part of the magic of suit construction is how to create all this ease of movement and yet never lose this nice smooth line around the chest. That's essential to it. Things like the pocket flaps, they were there for horseback riding, and they were put at a slant so that you could get your hand in at ease. The buttons underneath and the notch, it was all to be able to button your coat up front if you're hunting or if you're any kind of cold or chill, the coat's supposed to do that. So why do we have lapels? Well, we have them because it's supposed to fold over and keep you worn and, treat you like a coat. Yeah. Ticket pocket was there because if you were hunting, you needed a ticket to show that you had a right to go in someone else's land. Yeah. And for years, I thought it was just for a bus ticket.
I thought it was for theater tickets. No. People used to go to theaters in the evenings.
Not theater, not buses, but hunting. That's why it's there. Probably they used it for theaters, but originally, yeah. Yeah. This is why the details of sport and the details of a military life are so essential to the construction of the suit. Yeah. 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 Even the buttons on the back of the tail, they're there as flaps to protect so that you could button up your tail and it wouldn't get muddy.
When you're riding a horse.
Yeah.
I think you're absolutely right. I think sort of the working class kids that came into this trade, they were sort of 15, 16, 17. They didn't go to college or further education. So their education really, between that crucial period of 15 to 21, 22, was done here on the job. And that really sort of like garnishes and creates a passion in them. And we've always said in the trade, really, ideally, it's better to have someone that's on the younger side than someone that's more formed, that's 24, 25 coming into the trade. And I think that sort of period then is crucial.
It's a tough life, and like when you served your apprenticeship at that period, that's when you really start to learn how your craft is all going to come together. And that period is kind of a make or break time. There's been many people who've served their time as apprenticeships and then disappeared from the trade. So it's a hard time of struggling to get enough work, the cutters and the shops and the different houses having enough confidence in you to provide you with work that you earn a living from.
but it takes about 10 years to train to know what you do inside out. For me to do something for you to have confidence in me, you've got to go through that. And then that's where the perfection comes in, because it becomes second nature. So you get up in the morning, you come to work, and you get to your cutting bench. You instinctively know what to do and how to do it. How just a feeling, something that gets in you, and you never let it go. You really, you don't let it go. For example, just little things. When you start off, you're given basic jobs to do, real horrible basic jobs. You come into this trade and you want to be as great as the man that's teaching you. You want to do what he does, but you can't. So, example, he gives you something to sort out, a big bowl of buttons, to take out the buttons one by one and sort them out in sections to keep them together, that kind of thing. So you're doing that day in, day out. And in your head, all you're thinking about is these, you know, I want to do what you're doing. Yeah. I want to be as good as you. I want to do what you're doing. But you can't. You have to go through that process. You see, when I'm going home on the train, you're always looking at people, and you're looking at people's postures and their body and how they stand, and you're thinking, what would I do to that pattern? What would I do to his, he's wearing a jacket, what would I do to that jacket to make it perfect, fit perfect? What do I do? I'll pick up the shoulders, I'll take it in a bit, I'll lengthen it. You know, you kind of play games with your own mind. You see, you never switch off. A tailor's always working. Always working, I'm always working. I haven't taken a day off since I started. We're artists in a way. We create these things from start to finish, and you put everything into it. And when it's not greeted with love, you know, it does hurt.
I began traveling for the company when I was very young. In those days, you know, movie stars were, you know, they were huge personalities. The studios, it was important that the studios made sure that they were opulent, you know, they were larger than life. So we had, most of the Hollywood film directors were clients of ours, and many of the famous Hollywood stars. And I was very fortunate, because going out to the United States, I would visit the studios and sort of be set up my little shop, which is a miniaturized shop of what you see here. And then in between takes, the actors would come and they would choose their clothes and be measured, etc. And so we had, you know, customers for Gregory Peck, for example, who I had the pleasure of making for something like 45 years. And his son, in fact, comes to us now.
Things like the tools, and you can't get them anymore. You know, tools are passed down from generation to generation. Yeah, because, and books, you can't get them now because the industry has shrunk that much. So if you teach me, when you retire one day, you pass down your scissors to me, and your sticks and your rulers and whatever you have to me, because, you know, I will look after them. I will care for them. Don't let anybody use your tools. No, my scissors, my ruler, because that's my livelihood. That's what I get up every day, and my scissors are there. I pick them up and I instinctively know what to do with them. Yeah. You know, you just, you know. And if anybody has used my scissors, I know, because it's the way it cuts. Because your grip is different from mine, and the way you cut is just totally different. And the blades, they kind of go out of line. But there's another thing which we call a graphite. It's the same material that's in a pencil, the graphite.
Yeah,
it's the same thing as that. That's something that we don't really let anybody else use because it's very rare. They don't sell it anymore. So if you get hold of a graphite, it's gold. Now that is not something you let anybody use or let anybody get hold of, because that is sacred. That's yours. I mean, I've got a few of them now, and they're well hidden. Yeah,
They're well hidden.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about people being in the trade from perhaps 16 years of age to 70, 80, 90 years of age even. And that's really the what they love about it, what they don't want to give up, because it gives them pleasure. And I think if you work with pleasure and if you enjoy what you do, the resulting product shows it.
That's luxury.
Yeah, that's luxury.
The superfluous, a very necessary thing, is what Voltaire once remarked of luxury. When a set of people from fairly humble backgrounds come together to create what is arguably a real high-end luxury product, the utmost love and authenticity with which they do it may in fact be the most poetic rebuttal to Voltaire.
Coming from the roof. And so, as you'd imagine, traffic completely stopped on the streets. People gathered all around.
Sorry to interrupt you, but my father, who worked next door at the time, he's the one who instigated, who stopped the band from playing from the noise.
Oh,
so I do
dear.
Feel guilty.
You should feel guilty. You should.
But no, I'm a Beatles fan myself.
Are you? And what was your father doing? Was he a paper or was he?
Oh, no, he was a woolen merchant next door, Wayne Chill.
Oh my goodness! Yes!
To
keep all the police.
I'm afraid so, yes.
Yeah, and it was because of
the voice.
Right.
What was your
Jack Gathercole. Right. Well, thank you. Oh, wonderful. You could just
Sorry? Yeah, well, I feel guilty.